So I want to give you some updates on recent results from modeling and measurements of offshore wind farm cluster atmosphere interaction that we are investigating our project Crosswakes, that is funded by the Federal Ministry of Economic Affairs and Energy in Germany. And I have to thank the whole consortium for putting together some recent results for this talk. For short motivation, so Germany has currently the second largest capacity of offshore wind farms connected to the grid, and we saw a quite big increase, especially around the year 2015, and expect much more wind farms to be connected to the grid within the next years. And at the moment, we have about 6 gigawatts that are located in the German Bight only. And there are even long-term goals of the German government to increase that further. So until the year 2030, we expect to have 20 gigawatts connected to the grid and 2040, about 40 gigawatts installed in the German Bight. And so this is how this will likely look like around 2030, likely because we are in the face of election and things might change. Yeah, as you can see here, then for the year 2040, areas are already very limited with respect to that. So if you would end up here, nature protection areas or other zones that are reserved for traffic, the areas are already very limited. So this means we need a good spatial planning and really understand the wake effects that are happening with the increasing installation of offshore wind farms. And for that, we have set up the project Crosswakes, where we are looking into large-scale wake atmosphere interaction that and how they affect the real-life wind farm operation and how these can be modeled adequately. So, and we are cooperating here with several large wind farm operators that are active in the German Bight. In the project, we are focusing on three different topics. So one is the impact of coastal effects, because for the majority of wind directions, we do have a close coastline, quite close to the wind farms. And then on the other scales, we are looking into a single wind farm cluster interaction with the marine atmospheric boundary layer. So this includes the topic of global blockage, and then on the very large scale, the interaction of several large wind farm clusters with each other and the marine atmospheric boundary layer. And then by the end of the project, we plan to do some scenario calculations to rate the future wind farm expansion plans up to the year 2030. So the project consists of several research partners and UL International as a funded partners, and as I said, several offshore wind farm operators, and we are also in very close cooperation with the Federal Maritime and Hydrographic Agency, the BSH, that is responsible for the spatial planning in the German Bight and also in the Baltic Sea. So we're a bit more halfway through the project, so that's why I'm able to show you some results. And we have split that into results related to measurement activities, which originate from flight data, satellite analysis, so that's satellite data analysis, and also LiDAR measurements with profiling and scanning LiDAR that we are doing in the German Bight and as part of the project. On the other hand, the modeling activities, which are focusing on also different models. So on the high fidelity side, we have mesoscale simulations, where we are really looking into the full German Bight scale investigating the impact of these large-scale installations on the future wind resources, and also improving the current parameterizations that we do have. So here we are looking, we are working with the WARF model. Another model that we are using as part of the project, mainly for the investigation of single wind farm clusters and the interaction with the atmosphere. So that's focusing then on this scale of a single cluster, and also the topic of global blockage, where we looking using the model PIME. And then we have two industry models. One is a research industry model that's a Flappy farm layout program in Python that we are developing here at Fraunhofer IWIS, and OpenWind as a commercial model developed by UL. And in the project, we want to develop, or we are developing improved models for these large scale effects to reduce the uncertainty, especially in these models, because we believe they will still be used in the future for optimization and also things like post-construction analysis. Yes, to show some results here, so I have to say here that from the measurement part, I only present one slide here with some measurement results, because right after my talk, there will be Jörge Schneemann from the University of Oldenburg presenting, and he has some more results from scanning LiDAR analysis out of our project. So that's why I focus here on results that are related to the flight activities. We had so far 49 flights with manned aircraft. So that's more than 160 flight hours that were partly even with two aircraft. So this was, I think, for the first time that two aircraft were measuring wake effects. And we had different campaigns focusing on different topics. So here you can see an example where the aircraft started at Wilhelmshaven and then were flying for during southerly winds, a pattern that is able to measure coastal effects, and how the wind changes with different distances to the coastline. So these are measurements then at hub height, and then profile. So the color scale shows here the height that the aircraft did. So it was going up and down for measuring profiles, and then at hub height, so around 100 meters, these long legs to measure coastal effects. And then what you can see from these slides, from the profiles, is that with the increasing distance from the coastline here, that nicely this internal boundary layer develops further on, and we see that the shear here then decreases in the lower layers. Then we have also different scanning LiDARs that are installed. So for instance, on one of the clusters, which is called N2 here around the wind farm Alpha Ventus, we have the PhenoMast and two scanning LiDARs that are in operation here around these clusters. And we can then measure the inflow, the wind conditions inside such a big wind farm clusters, and also the outflow and approach of the next wind farm cluster here. With this setup, and those data are currently processed with the aim of providing validation data, in particular for mesoscale, but also for engineering wake models. Yes, some results for modeling. So this is a similar flight track that was taken here. So there were measurements of different profiles with the aircraft at different positions here, again during southerly winds with different distances from the coastline. And then we have run wharf simulations with different settings. So with the classical, let's say, NEVA model setup, then a YSU approach, and then the new 3D TKE scheme, which is actually a model to support also a gray zone modeling here, and we run simulations with a resolution of 1 kilometer. And what we can see here from these plots is quite nicely that especially for the temperature, so the potential temperature that's shown here, this new 3D TKE scheme gives much better representation of the temperature profile, especially closer to the coastline here, and also for the wind, this new model or new parametrization that was recently introduced into the WRF code provides better results for this coastal area. So quite promising results with respect to that. But what we also found here, and that can lead to further improvements, is that we definitely need a correct representation of surface temperature and the land sea mass. So whoever has been in this area, we do have here the Wadden Sea, and every 6 hours, large parts here fall dry and wet and dry. And so we have to really include a land sea mass that is changing over time. And that's what a postdoc is currently working on, getting such a time varying sea and land mass and sea surface temperature into the model to even better represent these profiles. Another topic, as I said, what we are looking on are simulations of global blockage. And for that, we are comparing engineering models with LES. And here you can see how two different engineering model approaches looks like. So if this is a 7x7 turbine idealized wind farm, and without any induction model, we don't see any blockage effect at all. So here we have a simple induction model that that shows quite nicely how the wind is slowing down in the first row here, but on the other side you see here for this large wind farm that the picture in LES looks much different because we have zones of speed ups inside the wind farms and then different slowdown also upstream of the wind farm cluster. And what we also saw in the project here as part of these PIME LES simulations, that we see a strong impact of the atmospheric boundary layer height in the simulations. And what is shown here in the lower panel are in the upper one a small wind farm. So this is a 3x3 wind farm, and the dashed contours here give the LES. And the colored contours do give results from three different induction models, blockage models that exist for engineering models. So there it works reasonably well with all three models, let's say, so for a small wind farm. But if we increase that to the large wind farm, so this is the case here of 7x7 turbines and then a turbine in the center, and we see here that there's a very big deviation of the dashed contours to the colored contours. So none of the three models is capable in adequately resolving this effect. And that's why we have a PhD, Gabriele Centurelli at the University of Oldenburg, who's currently looking into developing new blockage model. And we are also have a joint effort at the moment of our project together with the industry-led OWA GLOBE project that's especially focusing on this atmosphere interaction and running a large measurement campaign that we are also taking part in the German BITE. Another topic on the larger scale is the topic of these cluster wakes. And here we do see a satellite image of the situation with westerly winds, and then these winds do turn when approaching the coastline. So this was in the year 2018, and we saw that we see here that these wakes also quite nicely turn towards the coastline. And then we ran this case with a classical engineering model where we evaluated the wind speed at every single wind farm cluster from a mesoscale wind field, but the wakes are propagating in the classical approach just with the inflow direction at this coastline, and we see this quite big deviation between the two representation here of the wakes. So our question was, how can we improve these fast engineering models by including such large scale effects into this approach? And for that, I show you now here the classical approach. Then we implemented a new model that uses not only the the information about the wind direction and wind speed in the inflow of the cluster, but also the streamlines downstream. And so in that case here, then the wakes do follow the streamlines of the flow. And we see here that we are much better able to represent actually this curvature here of the large scale wake effects. And the computational speed almost stays the same in this case, because we are more or less just number crunching, calculating streamlines from a mesoscale data set that we can pre-calculate, that we do have. So in that case here, that is the data set from the New European Wind Atlas that we are using. And yeah, we are then able to improve these results. But now I've shown you a single situation, and for planning of wind farms and especially for financing questions, we are not interested in improving these single situations, but rather what's happening on an annual energy production timescale. And that's why in this case we have then evaluated two wind farm clusters, and the difference was by using this new model and not on the power production of the two wind farm clusters. And we see that this is the effect on an AAP scale is in the order of 0.5 to 1%. But keeping these large investments that we see in the German Bytes into account, this is already an effect can improve the wake modeling, which is still a key contributor to the overall uncertainty. And now with this publication that's soon to be submitted, we hope that the industry will take this over to improve also the models in that are used. And one last topic that I want to show here. So we are doing scenario calculations, as I've said, also for the future scenario, but this is now a simulation that we did with for the currently SDS scenario, so this year and next year, so last year and this year, because we don't see any new wind farms getting into operation this year in Germany. We ran a case here, including all wind farms in the German Bight and the Hornsdorf and Gemini wind farms that are close to the German Bight area, and ran two different wind farm parameterizations. So one is the EWP model that we have implemented into the newest WARF version, was this summer published by DTU. And what we show here is that the Fitch model shows higher wake effects, but more reliable results, let's say, inside the wind farm cluster. So the inner park wake effects seem to be better represented by the Fitch model than the EWP model, which was also shown in a recent publication by DTU. But if we have these two parameterizations and just compare, what they show us at the moment is that we do see a difference inside the wind farm clusters of up to 7%. Luckily, in the scales that we are interested in when using these models, so around, let's say, 10 to 30 kilometers downstream of the wind farm clusters, the difference aren't that large. So there it's in the order of 1% or less. But what we clearly see here is that we need further validation, especially also on these long time scales. So there are quite good validations for single situations for both models, but we do need validations also on these longer time scales. And that's why we are here in the project currently focusing on using SCADA data from different wind farms for doing a validation based on the production data.
Yes, okay, so that's my 1 minute. Martin,
my last slide already. Yeah. So I think what I want to say here are two more things that I haven't shown in the slides before, is that we definitely lead a cross-border planning and also joint research between North Sea and Baltic Sea states, because we, if you look into the future development plans, we do see that there's clusters right next to each other, right across the borders, and we do definitely need to engage here also better in the scientific community, and looking forward for further collaboration. That's what I wanted to say.
Thank you very much, Martin. Thank you. Some questions? Is anyone here physically with a question whilst we wait for anyone to chat a question? I have a question. I thought the slide you showed with the engineering models and all of the different directions was really illustrative of a kind of... so that was really brilliant to see.
Yeah,
no, also the one before, which was sort of like the more like kind of the state of the art and how you've then advanced it. I was wondering if you could account for, if you're using the streamlines, so that's kind of an instantaneous picture of the flow. Is it? Do you also account for how the streamlines evolve in time, so that there would be more like a trajectory of the wake? Because also, the thrust of you know what's happening at the wind farm is also changing in time. So
yes. So what we do evaluate. It's not only the, so we have two options, only using the wind direction, but also use the change in the gradient of the wind speed. But what we, of course, then do not see is how the, so within the wind farm cluster itself, there is a change then, but the wake itself does then not change currently. So it's just then propagated further downstream.
I thought that was very nice. Whilst I wait for more typing from those online, I had another question which was related to the you were saying the improvement in the use of the 3D TKE parameterization. Does it come at any additional computational cost?
I'm not 100% sure, but I mean, we ran here a simulation of 1 kilometer and we compared with 1 kilometer resolution, and we compared a 1 kilometer resolution also in the YSU scheme. And as far as I remember, it's at least not much.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Just curious. I don't know if it's. Yep. I mean, know.
The scheme itself is also made for looking more further towards gray zone modeling. Then of course you have an increase of the computing time if you go down with the resolution. Sure. But if you compare with the same resolution, as far as I remember, it's not much.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Fine. Thanks. Well, I think we'll move on. But I thought that was a very nice talk. Especially you really were showing modeling and measurement spanning so many scales there, so it was really living up to the session title. So thank you very much, Martin.
Thank you. Thank you for inviting us.